Hello and welcome to everyone. Today's session is part of the Cambridge Live Experience, and the title of the session is actually Helping Learners Build Their Social and Emotional Foundation for the Year Ahead. My name is Sarah Ellis, and I work in the Assessment Services team for Cambridge Assessment English, based in Bologna in Italy. This presentation is obviously going to be held by Iris B. And Iris is the Assessment Services Manager for Cambridge Assessment English in Greater China. It's useful to know that actually she is passionate about psychology and passionate about well-being. Before we actually start the session, just to say that like many of you, we are working from home and we're aiming to give you the best experience we can. But of course, we are relying on home Wi-Fi. So please bear with us if we do actually have any issues. Hopefully not, but just so you know. Before we start, particularly for those of you who are joining for the first time, we have a few suggestions to help you get the most out of today's session. We recommend, if possible, that you wear headphones so that you get better quality audio. And also, we would suggest if you've got other computer programs open, particularly something like Skype, it may be better to switch them off so it makes the platform more stable for you. Don't worry if at the first the picture is a bit blurry, because obviously we're working on the internet. It hopefully will improve as we go through the session. During the webinar, you'll need to use the chat box. For those of you who've just joined, you may find that at the bottom of your screen or at the top of the screen. So we'd like to invite you to use the chat box if you'd like to make a comment or to answer questions that Iris may ask you during the session. The Q&A box, you can actually, if you would like to write any questions you have for Iris in the Q&A box. And if the question is something we can answer straight away, we have a team in behind the scenes who will also be answering your questions. But don't worry if your question isn't answered straight away, because some questions we'll keep for the Q&A session at the end of the talk. So just so everybody knows, you will be receiving a certificate, you will be given a link, so don't worry about that. We'll make sure that you get your certificates at the end of the session. So without more to do, I'd like to pass over to you, Iris, and thank you very much. So over to you.
Thank you, Sarah, for your lovely introduction and being such a nice host. And good morning, good evening, and good afternoon to everybody here. And I'm calling from Shanghai. I'm Iris. It's 2 p.m. here. Thanks for all of you joining us today. No matter where you just get up for this session or you're staying up late, we really appreciate it. And today our topic is building our learners' social emotional foundation for the year ahead. But I like to point it out, it's not only about this year ahead, it is the foundation for the future life as well. So today, we are going to mainly cover two parts. The first part, we are going to get to know a little bit better about the social-emotional learning competencies. And in the second part, we're going to look at some classroom practice that you might use in your classroom or even teaching at home. So first, I would like to get to know you a little bit more. So Amy, can you kindly help roll out this poll to our attendees? So in terms of social emotional learning, how much do you know about this subject? Is this the first time you have heard about it? Or you heard about it, but you don't really know about the detail? Or you are already teaching the core competencies and integrating into your classroom activities. I'll give you 5 more seconds to vote. And then Amy, later, can you kindly show the results to all of us so we get to know how we know about this subject? Okay, great. So you may probably all can see now that maybe about half of our team here heard about this first time, and most of us may not know the detail about it, but don't worry, we are going to get to know a little bit more about this. And also, if you know about like 21st century skills or growth mindset or positive psychology or Cambridge life competencies, they really share a lot in common, so don't worry. And they are just like wearing different hats and also have different priorities and focus. So a little bit introduction about social emotional competencies. So this is a very classic and popular model of social emotional learning, which comprises mainly five parts and five core competencies. And I'd like to see self-awareness as the starting point, as I think this order can be aligned with how we develop our own emotional and the cognitive competence in our life as well, from when we were younger, like infant, till later we get older, become adults. So usually we start from getting a better understanding of ourselves, which is self-awareness. And then when we recognize our own emotions and values more, we are able to manage ourselves more better. And so after that, we can go beyond to build relationships with other people and see how we and where we are like in this world and in this society. And with all those four competencies of self-awareness, self-management, social awareness, and the relationship skills, then we can help no matter us or the kids to make every single responsible decision in their life to be a happy and a successful person. So maybe you might be wondering, what are those social emotional skills look like maybe in everyday life to every person? So I'm going to give you three examples. Probably as teachers or parents, you know can-do statements. So I'm going to show you three can-do statements related to social emotional learning. So you may need to guess which competency does it refer to. So the first competence is can demonstrate accurate self-perception and describe their own multiple personal characteristics realistically. I give you four options. Do you think this demonstrates the self-awareness, social awareness, social management, or responsible decision-making? Feel free to type your thoughts in the chat box. Okay, we are seeing some of the answers coming through, and most of you voted A, a few of them maybe B, but majority is A. You're right, like this mainly refers to self-awareness because it's related to your understanding of your own feelings and the characteristics. Yeah, but I think no harm saying that it's also related to others, because self-awareness is the foundation for other competencies as well. They are not like totally clear-cut or separate, right? They are also interrelated. So thanks for sharing your thoughts. So what about the second competence? Maybe some of them already see the answer, but so the second competence is the person can independently using coping strategies to deal with difficult feelings or stress. Do you think it's self-awareness or social awareness or self-management or responsible decision-making? Good morning. I can see that a lot of answers are self-management. You're right, it's about how we manage ourselves and in order to organize our life better, right? So mainly it's a self-management, yes. And then our last one is the person can recognize other feelings and begin to guess why they might be different from their own feelings. I hope you didn't see it. Okay. So is this self-awareness, social awareness, self-management, or responsible decision-making? Okay. I think most of us agree that This can-do statement refers to social awareness, because it's not only about us, it's also about understanding others, specifically the empathy, the ability to empathize other people's feelings. So I hope that with the three can-do statements, you get to know a bit more about the different competencies in social emotional learning and the social awareness. Sorry, it takes a bit time to load. So from social awareness to social management, from self-awareness to self-management to social awareness. Then we build like our we can build our kids social emotional competencies step by step in this way. So that's why I think it's a very good model, a guideline for us to teach those competencies in our classroom or at home. Okay, great. So just now we look at the three can-do statements of competencies. And I'd like to ask you to think about from age group, do you think those competencies start to develop or represent? What do you think? Is it from preschool or kindergarten or middle school, high school or university? I can see a lot of answers are either A or B. Yeah, I think you are quite right. I agree with you. And I think people have, like, although kids develop in different pace. So I think there is a little bit latency in the slide. So although kids like have their own pace in development, but generally there are some key milestones. And according to one of the state standards for developing social emotional learning in USA, those competencies are started to mainly develop from kindergarten. But I have to say that a lot of competencies also like start developing immediately after, like in the first few months when we are born. Like people, for example, the baby may respond to other people's smile, right? But according to this guideline, those competencies can develop drastically from preschool and kindergarten. So that's why it's very important that at the beginning of the education journey, we need to focus on those social emotional learning. And also, if we reflect on ourselves, for example, if I reflect on myself, like sometimes even I can't show, like mindfully show all those competencies either. For example, maybe I wouldn't be able to maintain all those positive relationships. So it's important that we work on them at every stage of our journey of life, especially in early year. As an educator, that's what we can do. Okay, so that's why I like to show this quote from National Scientific Council on the Developing Child. The foundation of those core competencies are developed in the early, like in the early stage, but it can have a long lasting impact and it can be cultivated later in life as well. So what can we do to help our kids demonstrate them and demonstrate and develop those competencies then? So I like to start with self-awareness. And I'm using an acronym here, which is TTT. If you study CELTA or before you got some teacher training before, you probably know TTT means teacher talking time. So I hope in this way, you can remember it better. But in here, TTT means teach, tell, and tone. So the first thing is that we need to make those feeling and emotional words explicit in the classroom. Probably some of you already use, like teach them in classroom, but what we can do is that to make the students even more aware, especially more aware of those nuanced feelings or granular feelings. For example, even under a feeling of anger or happiness, actually there is a whole family of happiness feeling or anger feeling under this category, as you can see from this chart. So as some psychologists said, if you are able to describe your emotions even more in an exact and a granular way, so usually you are more able to regulate them as well. What we call, you can name it to tame it. So you can introduce those kind of beautiful wheel charts, like in your, no matter at home or in class, to make those vocabulary words even more explicit. And some classroom activities or home activities you can do includes emotion naming exercise. For example, you can ask kids to do some emotional statements, like today I feel happy and because blah, blah, blah. The reason why I highlight because is that one way explore and describe our emotions, it's not only about the key point is why we feel in that way. So uncover the reason behind it is very important. It's a way to help our kids to be more aware and mindful of their feelings. And you can also do some games with flashcards or bingo. And also for younger kids, if they like to get more hands-on experience, you can do some craft activities with them as well. For example, making emotion sticks or write some display cards. Like even though you are teaching remotely, for example, using some platforms such as Zoom, when we are video calling your students, you can even ask your students to act out those feelings and ask other students to guess. So it's also a way to engage them as well. Okay, so talking about that's the activity under teach. So after we teach those vocabularies to our students, after they become more aware of those feelings, then we need to create opportunities and chance for them to share and articulate, right? So that's why we can create a kindness tree or wall in classroom, or even appreciate wall. And for example, I work in Cambridge Assessment, in our kind of company platform, we even have a section called the appreciative wall, where we can appreciate each other colleagues, the kindness act. So I think that is a very good routine to do in your classroom or at home. Also, you can create a mood display board as well. If you think you are teaching online now, don't worry. There are some e-board you can use as well, such as Padlet. I'm giving you an example here, although it's not about mood, but you can imagine how you maybe introduce the words of the day as a nuanced feeling word, or you can just create a mood board on Padlet and ask students to write down how they are feeling today and why. And in that way, you can create the opportunities for them to share and express the feelings. And another thing that is nice to do, no matter at home in class, is to have a gratitude jar. You can have a classroom gratitude jar, and or you can have a home gratitude jar. The main point is that it's not only about writing what you are grateful for, but also why. Because I used to do this routine, and the first time I did it, I only wrote what happened. For example, just use a few words. And at the end of the month, I will open the jar and then review all those cards I wrote. But the thing is, sometimes I couldn't remember. So that's the lesson I learned. If you are going to do this, no matter with your kids or with your students, you remember to remind them to write down why they feel grateful and to make it a little bit more detailed. So maybe at the end of the month, when they review it, they really can have this kind of, they will review this sense of gratitude again. That is very helpful. And you can even ask your kids to write a gratitude card, to their parents, and then bring another gratitude card empty one to their parents. Ask their parents to write something that they feel grateful to their kids. So in that way, we encourage, we build the bond between school and home, parents and kids as well. Okay, so that's the tail part. And another activity you can do is to, some things you can introduce to your class is use this kind of traffic light bracelet. If you think of this kind of bracelets are like a safe for your age group, it really depends. If you don't think they are safe, don't worry. You can just bring some marker pen and then like ask kids or your students to draw the bracelets on their wrists, right? And they also saves those bracelets. Yeah, and so because the bracelets are of different colors, so they indicate different moods. It's kind of like a, you know, mood check-in before your class, you know, at the beginning of your class or at the beginning of the day. So every kid, even yourself, will wear a bracelet or draw a bracelet. So other kids will know how are the classmates feeling today. And I think that is helpful, is because it's not only a way to express their feeling and mood, but also because other people, you can see what are their other kids feeling, then you give them a chance to ask, to show empathy to other people. Like, why are you feeling not okay today? What can you do, right? Even some of the kids or students don't feel like talking today, you can create even another color to indicate, oh, I just want to be on my own today, you know, just please give me some room. So there's a lot of creativity you can integrate in this kind of routine. And I always believe that our teachers and the parents are the best artists in the world, you know, because you have to adjust to what's best for your students. And the journaling definitely is very helpful. And I see in the program of Cambridge Live Experience, there's a session dedicated to this. So I'm not going to elaborate, but to check it out if you are interested. So about the tone, I think it's very important to set the tone for your classroom to make sure every student, every teacher is on the same page. And the principle I'm quoting here is that it's important that we can notice those feelings, but we don't need to judge or blame ourselves, you know? It's okay to not feel okay. And yesterday I attended a session, a very inspiring session by Andy Cope, which is called The Art of Being Brilliant. He also mentioned similar ideas. Like, it's okay to not feel okay. Feelings are not us. So don't label us as feelings. They are just thoughts. So they are temporary. And sometimes it's also useful to show them some figures and facts. Like, it's normal for us to feel negative, you know, sometimes. But because feelings always fluctuate, okay? Yeah, I think by being aware of those facts, it can also help our students to understand feelings, what they really are. Okay. So that's about self-awareness. Once they become more aware of their feelings and the emotions, then we can give them some tools or guide to manage their emotions. And I would like to share with you three more tips as well. And you can see which one you may find helpful in your context. The first is always helpful to make it visual. For kids, you know, emotions, we feel them, but where they come from, how they are made of, then it's important, you can ask kids to draw them out. We can have a session, you know, focusing on emotions, and then at the end of the session, you can ask kids to work in group or work with their parents to draw this brain craftivity and to understand how our chemicals inside, how different parts of brain are responsible for different emotions. So next time, when they feel that certain kind of feeling, they know, oh, that part of the brain is working, or that part of chemical is working. Actually, by being a witness or observer of our feelings can help us regulate and manage our feelings. And I think those kind of a chemistry tube can be a good visualized tool for our students to understand their feelings as well. Another way to visualize our feeling is to give your chimp a name. Chimp means a chimpanzee. I got this idea from this book by a psychologist in America called Steve Peters, and he wrote a book about the chimp paradox. And what the main idea in this book is that in everybody's mind, a brain, there are different parts. There are mainly three parts. One is a chimpanzee, the other one is a human, you know, the rational one, and also the third one is a computer, is a system who is, you know, implementing things. And what is important is that the chimpanzee in our mind is five times more powerful than the rational person. So that's why we always sometimes feel the emotions that we might not like. We may jump into those survival models when we feel nervous with the fight or flight, right? So if it's also a good way to visualize and to personalize, personify our feelings, like to give your chimp a name. So you can tell your students as well, there's a chimp in everybody's brain. So can you give your chimp a name? After you give your chimp a name, then this chimp will be your friend. So if your friend feel negative or angry, what would you do in your to your friend, you know? Instead of blaming ourselves, what can you do to nurture it and make them feel better? So the point is that our inner chimp can either be our best friend or our worst enemy. And it really depends how we can manage how we interact with the chimp. Another way to visualize this with our kids, I got this idea also from another great YouTube video, is that you can use your hand as a model of the brain. And they usually in the brain there are two floors, right? There's downstairs and there's upstairs. And where does the chimp live? The chimp usually lives here. Sorry for my bad drawing. I know most of you can draw a better chimp than me. So usually the chimp lives in the first floor, which means every time we come across a situation, then the chimp will be activated first. But we can also go to the second floor to calm the chimp down, to calm ourselves down. So by doing this, we can also help our student to understand our brain, how the brain is related, how it works to make us feel a certain way. Okay. So another, besides making emotions visual, we can also make it physical. You know, our emotions can have effects on our body. For example, when you feel anger, you may feel like you want to clench your fist, you want to clench your teeth. But at the same time, what we do, how we move our body, can also affect our emotions. I think it's also helpful to let our students be aware of this fact as well. So after, like, you give them maybe a body, you know, outline to explore the feelings, like how feelings affect their body, then you can also ask them, what can you do to make yourself happy when you feel anger? For example, usually the more open your body is, the more relaxed you are, right? So you can do some activities like this to help your students to explore how they can use the body moves and gestures to make themselves happy. And this is also related to a very very inspiring TED talk by Amy Cuddy, and probably some of many of you have watched this as well. And this talk is also about how our body language can really shape our mindset. So if you are interested, you can also share this with your students if they are, you know, they are able to understand this topic. Okay. And so just now we talk about self-awareness and self-management. So let's go beyond ourselves and see how we can help our students to build a relationship with others. And the one important thing I think we can help our students do is to do some classroom activity to help them to bond with other people. For example, you can create a love tank. I got this idea from a book which called The Five Languages of Love. So in that book, the author said, like, we express love in different languages. Some people would like to do more surveys. Some people would like to say more positive language. And what we need to do, our goal is to make this love tank full. So you can either create a physical love tank on your blackboard or like your classroom, or you can create an electronic love tank on the Padlet. And then you ask your students, what can you do to make ourselves a class love tank full? So they can brainstorm what they can do to make the class better, make the classmates better, and what they can do to contribute to this class. I think this can be a good routine that you can use in your class or to your kids. And also some literature books and movies can be very helpful as well, because they can help students not like understand there are such a big diversity in the world. People live different lives, just like us today, coming from different backgrounds and nationalities, speaking different languages, living different culture. And by doing this, then they will be able to understand, oh, we are different. So I can't only just see things from my own view of standpoint, right? So what would they think in their shoes? So try to, then by getting to know that there is a big diversity, they will become more inclusive and they will be able to show empathy for other people. And by talking about this, I'd like to share with you a good website I found where there are a lot of good recommendation of books about shows teaching social justice. It's not only about social justice. They are like for younger kids, it recommends books introducing like kids living in different countries. And so it's very helpful website where you can find the books that you can use for your age group, ranging from early learning, preschool, until even high school. And what's amazing is that they even get like amazing books for teachers, like to tell teachers how we can integrate these kind of topics in our classroom. Okay, and another thing, so just now we talk about social awareness, and by introducing these books, you definitely can integrate some classroom activities as well, such as a list and draw or doing some role plays. Doing role plays is a very important activity that can help kids to understand how other people feeling and what other people are thinking about. List and draw, it sounds very easy. But it can take in different forms. For example, two kids they can face to do this and draw activity like face to face. They can also don't look at each other, and then one student has to listen carefully to the other person what they describe. And if you are teaching online, that's great. You can maybe. If you get a platform, you can allocate them into different smaller room, breakout rooms, and ask them to turn off the video, and then just listen to the other person, and then draw the thing that the other person is describing. And this is actually a good technique that coaching is using as a lot of a coaching program using to develop the active listening skills. So be creative and integrate this activity into your class when that's helpful. So just now we covered social awareness. So after our students get to know more about, who I am to the society, to the classroom, to the school, then we can also create some chances for them to bond deeper with their classmates or other people. And I think one important concept is to build a community, to give them a sense of belonging in the classroom. Like they don't just come to classroom to study, but they belong here because this is a community for them. What are some rituals or routines we can do to create this kind of community? One routine that I like most is shout out. For example, every Friday you can have this shout out session. You can bring a bartender bell, and then every time you hit the bell, ding, then a kid or a student will say, I have a shout out to someone. For example, for Sarah, my lovely host, I have a shout out to Sarah because Sarah was the first first person who gave me a Zoom induction like a few months ago when we just started teaching on Zoom. And also she took her time to give me feedback on my slides, and I feel really grateful. So it's not only about giving a shout out, it's also about helping them to explore why they feel grateful. And that can really help kids and students to bond with each other. And another one is group salutes. So it's very easy. You know, probably you do it in your class already. For example, you give high five to each other in a task. You know, you say some encouraging words, as we said, a pat on the shoulder. Those things, they sound very easy and common in everyday, but they have a significant impact on building community and building connections with others. Like if you are teaching online, you can even do this as well. And this can be very encouraging to a lot of students to give them affirmation and positive energy. Another thing that I like to mention is Rose and Thorn monthly board. For example, you can create what does this mean? Rose, for a monthly board, the rose means the student writes down one thing they look forward to or they want to achieve this month. The thorn means one thing that they feel challenging or an obstacle they are meeting now in their daily life. By asking every student to write on a post-it or write on an e-board, then everybody gets to know what other people are doing in their life, what they are looking forward to, what do they want to work on, what the challenges they are facing. And by getting to know other people, then that will create the chance for them to help each other, right? So I think this can be a good routine that you can integrate no matter at home or in school as well. So just now we talked about the four foundations, the self-awareness one and self-management, social awareness, and the relationship skills. As you can see from this chart, they are interrelated with each other. And as you can see from the previous slides, and a lot of activities, they are not only just for cultivating one core competencies, right? By doing one activity or routine or ritual, you are actually nurture or nourish all the different kind of core competencies. And hopefully by doing those activities, we can help our kids to build those foundations. Then they can become responsible and in their daily life, in their future life, not only study, but also in future life as well. They become not only a successful person, but also a happy person in life. Okay, and one last point I would like to point out is, sorry, there is some latency in the slide. Oh, sorry. Is that, you know, we are educators. We spend a lot of time we have a really important role in our students' life. So it's always important to start with ourselves. We are our kids' role model. We are our students' role model. You know, they are young. They are just sponge. They absorb what they see and they absorb massively what they observe. So let's start with ourselves. We are our students' best role model. So we can do those and demonstrate those, then they will definitely follow. And what I want to say in the end is that although there are different activities, seem like there are quite a lot, but as you are the artist in your classroom, you decide what you like to integrate into your classroom or home practice, home teaching. Okay, so this will come to the end of my session. If you have any questions, feel free to let us know. And I hope you find something that that will be helpful in your teaching.
Well, thank you very much, Iris, for that very inspiring talk, full of lots of practical ideas, and there's been lots of very positive feedback in the chat. We have got quite a lot of questions. We've just got time to answer a few. We'll try and answer as many as possible. I would just personally like to say thank you for the shout out, and you also got some shout outs in the chat. So again, thank you so much for that.
I have a shout out to all the participants.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, thank you to the participants. Yes, a shout out to the participants for coming to this session. Okay, a couple of quick questions. One of our participants is asking about what age we could start using gratitude jars, do you think?
I think you can start, I don't have a lot of experience teaching like very young kids, like kindergarten. But I think if you like to, you can start, try it, like with your classroom. For example, if you are teaching kindergarten kids or like primary school kids, I think primary school kids can definitely do that. For kindergarten, maybe they will not be able to write a lot, but still they can draw, you know. So it doesn't mean that they have to write full sentences. Like if they can draw, drawing is a great way to express their gratitude as well. They can draw a small, you know, character showing what they feel grateful as well, if that's doable for your kids. So I think it just no harm experimenting what works for your kids. And I think, you can start with a drawing, you know, if your kids can't write or anything.
Okay, thank you for that. And also we have a question about you, the bracelets, the coloured bracelets. What do we, what can you do about a child who always wears the red bracelet to draw attention to themselves?
Oh yeah, this is a very, very good question. I think for as you said, this kid wears the red bracelets, not because he or she feels in that way, but she wants to draw attention, that I think probably it's good to maybe talk to this kid, like these students, like in private. I think to really know what's behind this, like attention drawing, because I think once a kid wants some attention, which means he or she needs something, you know, behind the scene. So I think it's important to know that part, the behind the scene part, and then take actions based on that. This will be my solution or thinking, because I think it's really hard to be specific, but I think this can be a good general guideline. Thank you for the question. It's a very thoughtful question.
And that's related to that question. What do you suggest the teacher does if when they're checking the mood display, the child says they're angry or upset?
Oh, I think this is if the child says I'm angry or upset, then don't stop there. You know, it's very important to maybe explore later in class, because maybe the kid will feel conscious if you go further, like in the class. But later in class, later after the class, I think if this will be a very good chance to talk with a kid deeper about this, because not every single kid is open, you know. Some kids won't show that they are upset or angry, but if the kid is open, they show their expression, negative feelings, which means they are open to you. So I think take the chance after class to maybe talk with them, and then to focus on what we can help to, like we can do together to make you feel better, instead of just focusing on the negative part. And I remember, you know, when we are teaching younger learners, sometimes we sing songs like how are you feeling, I'm happy. So some kids, they don't know how to show negative feelings. So showing negative feelings actually for in some way is a good positive sign, you know. So take the chance to explore more, to help them to open their hearts, to develop the abilities to express themselves. Thank you.
Thank you, Iris, for that. And for just chance for one last question, I think. A couple of people have been asking about shyer adults, and also activities for the shy and introvert. Could you perhaps highlight some of the activities for those who are shy and introvert?
Oh, shy and introverts. I think first is respect, you know, because a shy and introverts, like shy is a kind of like shy and introverts. They are not only about feelings, they are personality, part of personality as well. So I think the first principle is that no personalities are bad. You know, introvert and shy person, they have their like a bright light, they have their strength as well. So I think it's really important first to respect that they are shy and introvert. And the second, to make them feel safe, to be themselves, you know. And the third is that to encourage them to show their strength. Only by doing this, then we can help them build their confidence to be a little bit more outward, to work with other people. So I think there could be some good principles to follow. So first respect, and then make them feel safe, and then make them shine. Then they will feel more confident to go outward. Yes.
Well, thank you, Iris. And I think actually we've run out of time. I'm sorry we haven't been able to answer all the questions. But thank you very much again, Iris, for this fantastic session. Thank you to our colleagues behind the scene. And of course, a big thank you to everyone who's attended the session. And we thank you very much again. So thank you, Iris, so much. I'll say goodbye. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Have a lovely day. Thank you so much.